detecting a massive object emerging from hyperspace.
Knights of the Old Republic came out in 2003 and remains to this day to be my favorite and arguably the fanbase's favorite Star Wars video game. A common issue that takes place among Star Wars, anything really in Star Wars nowadays, is that it has to fit into Disney's canon. Jedi Fallen Order takes place 5 years after Revenge of the Sith and thus 14 years before the events of A New Hope, so it has to fit in. You want dark side users, you have to use Inquisitors. You want a really big bad, you have to use Darth Vader. This isn't necessarily a con of the video game. However, it's worth noting that these are certain trappings that one falls into when making a video game. However, this game takes place 4,000 years before the Rise of the Empire, or 3,981 BBY for those of you who want to know. This game actually liberates itself from the trappings that come with making a video game or any story inside the realm that the Skywalker saga takes place. This game can easily tell a story that doesn't adhere to any rules. It can expand on concepts, early Jedi, early empires, and that's something that this game does really well. And I think that that's clearly one of the reasons that Knights of the Old Republic has been and stayed a staple and a household name for any Star Wars fan. It's been one of the greatest games that's ever graced Star Wars fans and is one of the greatest games ever to be released in general. It came around in a transitionary period. The graphics are looking dated, similar to how A New Hope special effects looked dated, but at the time these were revolutionary. That, combined with the fact that this is the first ever Star Wars RPG and proved that the concept was a solid one that could stand on its own, is one of just many reasons that this is the greatest Star Wars game to ever grace Star Wars fans, and why it is objectively a masterpiece. Just one of several excellent things about this game is that you are the character. You create them. They are not some cardboard cutout character that you have to follow around. I'm not saying that any Star Wars video game really has any cardboard cutout characters, but we are not following Cal Kestis. We are not following Iden Versio. We are following you. You create your character. It is you who determines their sex, looks, attributes, height, skin color, anything. You can make them a perfect copy of you. You also determine their personality. An excellent point of the game is that relationships can be stressed, strengthened, or just altogether changed by you picking dialogue. If I want to be close comrades with Karth, I can do that. If I want to be close with Bastila, I can do that. There's also this really crazy and interesting thing to note out about this game is that if you really want a full experience of Knights of the Old Republic, you have to play it through 4 times. Those 4 times are as a man or a woman of your class, it does not matter, and then you have to play the light side, grinding for light side points, and dark side, grinding for dark side points for each character, which will introduce new relationships. Obviously, you can have a different relationship with people just depending on what you are, but those are the 4 ways that you can play it, and I certainly recommend it. I myself have only played through the game twice, however, I have had vastly different experiences with both times. The first time I just played it through, kind of, you know, getting my bearings, and then recently I replayed it, and I grinded dark side completely. I picked the dark side ending, which is just phenomenal. The story is certainly one part of this game that stands out above all others when compared to any other kind of Star Wars game or really game in general, and that is that you wake up with amnesia, which is, admittedly, from a narrative perspective, a very cliche move, and yet from a gameplay gameplay standpoint, it's absolutely perfect. We know nothing about this era, we know nothing about this world, so waking up knowing nothing just like our character is us. There's no reveal that there's something that our character knew that we, the audience, didn't know because we are our character. What they know, we know. What we don't know, they also don't know. And the reveal is up there with Darth Vader's reveal that he was Luke's father. The reveal that you are in fact the villain that set the entire events of this video game in motion is up there as one of the greatest reveals of all time, and certainly in one of the first cinematic video games to ever grace the TV screens at home. This is really up there as a great character moment and a great moment narratively in the game. And just going back to those choices, you can pick what you do with this information. You can either be angry at the Jedi that they wiped your mind and that they chose to use you as a tool of the Jedi, and you can turn against them fighting for the Sith, or you can decide that you are better off as a light side member, that the Jedi restored Revan, you, to your former glory as a Jedi Knight, the hero of the Republic and of the Mandalorian War. It's these choices that you make in this game that change and elevate this game from a simple RPG to something that is really an experience that I recommend that everyone has. One great aspect of this game is that it does not have a linear storyline. Unlike, say, Jedi Fallen Order, where we have multiple planets that you can jump between all the time, it is very clear that you are meant to go to certain planets for certain things before venturing to others. There's a very clear line, and while you're able to jump around, the creators had a path in mind for you, the player. Knights of the Old Republic does not have that. You can go to any planet. The bosses that you fight throughout the game will present themselves to you on any planet. You can be on Kashyyyk, on Tatooine, on Manon, anywhere, really, Korriban, it doesn't matter. So long as you have progressed through the game and gone to a certain number of planets, at that point, a character will reveal himself as a boss battle, and it's certainly interesting. Having only played through the game 2 times, I can tell you that the 2 bosses that you fight in the middle of the game have been presented to me on different planets each time. I never went in the same order, and that's certainly something you can do. You can also revisit planets afterwards, similar to Jedi Fallen Order, but certainly to a much greater effect. And each of these planets feels unique and different and vibrant. You really sink into it. Just on Terrace alone, which is definitely the planet that you first start out on, it's kind of your little introductory planet. And going around the upper city to the lower city to then the underbelly of the whole planet, the undercity I believe it's called, is certainly just an experience altogether. It feels like different worlds that you're traveling to. And as I've said before, your decisions will affect the game. Your decisions will affect your scores, your points, where you can put force powers, whether you're a dark side adept or a light side adept. And there's certainly decisions. One of my favorite decisions that ultimately is a tragic irony is that you have to find a cure to deliver to a doctor who's in the upper city. He's tending to injured Republic soldiers who escaped from the crash, such as yourself. You can either give him the cure once you find it, of course, or you can sell it to the Hutts for much money. And no matter what you pick, Terrace is still going to be destroyed by Darth Malak, which is tragic. However, it still does affect your game, obviously giving you light side or dark side points. And since Terrace is such a big planet, at least as far as the map goes, we actually feel when Terrace is destroyed. When Darth Malak orders the bombing on Terrace, we actually feel when we see buildings crumple, when we see the Ebon Hawk escape, when we leave, it stirs a certain emotional response, and that is present in every single planet. I cannot think of a single planet that you are not presented with some kind of moral dilemma that will radically change whether or not you are light side or dark side adept. Manon. There's several side missions, but the main mission at the end decides whether or not you will poison the waters to get rid of a giant fish that will attack your submarine, or if you can simply affect some of the mechanics and push the fish away. Now, of course, this poison is the quicker and easier option, hence dark side. However, by poisoning the waters and thus killing the fish, you have also poisoned Manon's Kolto supply. See, Kolto is the predecessor to Bacta, and Manon is basically if Kamino and Switzerland both combined into one Star Wars planet. They're neutral, and by destroying a source of their biggest export, they actually ban you from going back to Manon. They eventually will release you, but you can't go back. You will immediately be arrested upon arrival. On Tatooine, you learn the history of the Tusken Raiders, and you have to decide whether or not you will fight them and collect their gaffy sticks. Among other things, you get to kill a crate dragon. On Kashyyyk, you have to deal with the slave trade with Circa Corporation, taking Wookiees and selling them as slave labor. You also get to go to a Wookiee village and help them with an internal struggle, where you also meet Jody Bindo, who is, as far as I can recollect, our first true glimpse into what a gray Jedi can be. Someone who is Force-side adept leaning, however, they don't pledge allegiance to the Jedi Order. They see them both fighting the Jedi and the Sith as simply continuing ongoing struggle where there is no true victor, and the best option for anyone to do is to simply leave altogether. On Dantooine, which is really only the second planet you go to, you have to decide whether or not you will kill a Jedi who has turned to the dark side. Now, you can do what I did and kill her, which, you know, just racks up dark side points, or you can save her and build that relationship with her. If you actually kill her, then when you go to Korriban, another planet, her master has fallen to the dark side and is trying to gain admittance into the Sith Academy. And on Korriban, you have to actually decide whether or not you will kill a Sith to gain power or ally with the Master against the Sith. It's really Sith versus Sith either way. There really is no clear-cut victory, but one will give you light side, one will give you dark side. And of course, there is the end-all decision of whether or not you will turn to the dark side against Malak, or you will stay with the light against Malak and fight with the Republic. You're either fighting as a usurper, or as, you know, just fighting with the Republic. And it's really an interesting choice because either way you go, the story takes crazy turns. But this game does so much more than just provide you with moral dilemmas. The game massively explores the Force, the empires that took place before the Sith Empire, such as the Eternal Empire, which was a Rakatan civilization that predates the Jedi and the Sith conflict. We also get the Starforge, which is, in my mind, the most logical superweapon. The Starforge is such a simple superweapon that it makes more sense than the Death Star. Rather than blowing up a planet or systems or crippling the planet that it's on, it simply uses a star, fueling it, to build ships for the Sith Empire. There's no crazy convenient, oh, if you hit this, then the whole thing will blow up. It's simply attacked by the Republic fleet, with the aid of Bastila's Battle Meditation, which is another expansion on Force power to be able to meditate and influence the mind and confidence of your enemy to make them feel weak, feel insignificant, feel like their battle is useless, while also making your own allies feel stronger, more powerful. There is simply not enough that I could say about this game. Another great thing is that if you want to get it on PC, on Xbox, it's actually just, I think a few years ago, it was actually had upgraded graphics on Xbox. But that's not all. Let's say you don't have a computer or a console, you can actually get this game on your phone, which just adds to its availability. It is truly one of the greatest video games that has ever been released, and one of the greatest Star Wars stories that we've ever had. Starts out simple, then only turns out to be a framing device, the amnesia that is, for a much bigger reveal, and unlike other Star Wars projects, this reveal is actually set up. And this is why it actually makes me a little bit sad that there are so many people that want to have this be adapted into a movie. I could not disagree with this more. Knights of the Old Republic is one of the densest video games ever, where each planet feels like its own story, each one has its own moral conflict, each one unlocks new dialogue with a character. To try and condense this into a movie, like, you could make an entire movie just about HK-47. Another pitfall of turning this into a movie is, how do you cast Revan? Do you make him a man? Do you make him a woman? What ethnicity do you make him? How do you have his character play out? Is he kind of more leaning to the light side? Is he leaning more to the dark side? There's no true way to adapt Revan. Revan is you. You, the player, are him. Your character is you. That's why he'd be terrible in a movie, because you have a studio deciding his character traits. Well, in every other iteration of him, you decide his character traits, which makes this an excellent video game and a terrible movie. Well, guys, I really don't know what I can say about Knights of the Old Republic that hasn't already been said before by several others. It was a revolutionary game, it was a new game of its time, it has an excellent story and a magnificent twist, incredibly crafted characters. You, yourself, are one of these incredibly crafted characters because they are you. A great story, great reveal. I could just go on and on about this forever. Even the side missions and side games like Swoop Bike Racing are incredibly fun. All the diverse worlds and seeing the different cultures from Kashyyyk to Manon to Tatooine, everything. Korriban especially is one of my favorite planets. I recommend you save Korriban as the last planet that you go to before you obviously go to Rakata Prime, which of course, again, amazing. This game is just, it's everything that I wish Star Wars games could be now. It's everything that I wish Star Wars could be right now. Immersive storytelling, a new era, expanding on the Force, expanding on Star Wars as we know it. This game, unlike any other, also shows something. We are not fighting on the small side that is trying to expand and restore what once was. We're not fighting on the side of the Republic versus the Separatist, which is just trying to combat and keep the peace. The side we are fighting on is a decaying Empire, or Republic, but I'm just using Empire kind of to make sense. We are fighting on the side of a decaying government. The Jedi are losing. The Sith are growing. And since this takes place before the time of Darth Bane, there are thousands of Sith. KOTOR tells an entirely unique story, and it is a game that, thank God, it had at least one sequel. I don't play Star Wars The Old Republic, but, you know, I've heard from several people it's good, just not my thing. I don't really like MMOs. But if you haven't played Knights of the Old Republic, then you need to play Knights of the Old Republic. I would wholeheartedly recommend this game to anyone, whether or not you are a big Star Wars fan or you've just gotten into Star Wars. It is the perfect thing to dip your toe into the expanded universe. It is unfortunately not canon, as many of you are aware, but it is still an excellent story worth listening to and playing through. As I've said many times now already, probably to the point of annoyance, it is the greatest Star Wars game that we have ever had. Thanks for watching, and as always, I'll see you again next time.